Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining our webinar. My name is Aayush Singh. I lead the Catalysis platform here at SandboxAQ, and I'm excited to tell you about a recent project from our group titled AQCat25, Unlocking Spin-Aware High-Fidelity Machine Learning Potentials for Heterogeneous Catalysis. So at SandboxAQ, we focus on the quantitative core of the global economy. As opposed to large language models or LLMs, which are trained on text-based data, our large quantitative models are trained on physics-based data, and they help us tackle very large trillion-dollar quantitative economy. We work on problems ranging from drug discovery to battery chemistry, alloy development, polymer formulations, and of course, catalysis. Catalysis, if you're not familiar, is key to innovation in the chemical industry and society. There are a large number of technologies that we rely on as a society. For example, fertilizer for food production, emissions control for clean air, fuel production, plastics production. Many of these technologies are only possible because of innovation in the catalyst materials space. And what excites us at SandboxAQ is that you can see on the right, there are a large number of unsolved critical problems in catalysis, and we're very excited about using AI-based methods to try to address some of them. Now, computational methods have been used in catalyst discovery for a long time, more than 20 years, and a lot of these methods are based on quantum chemistry density functional theory calculations, which are very expensive and very accurate. These density functional theory calculations are performed over large networks of reactions, and these energies are put into what are called microkinetic models to predict catalyst performance. Typically, density functional theory methods are used to create these volcano plots, as shown on the right, which predict activity or selectivity of catalysts as a function of descriptors of binding on the catalyst surface. Traditional DFT-based microkinetic modeling has a number of successes. These successes are usually limited to simple reaction networks on well-defined catalyst facets. An example of that is thermochemical ammonia synthesis, where more than 20 years ago, theory was used to predict a cobalt molybdenum catalyst, which was then verified experimentally. Now, a number of the problems that we would like to solve today are highly complex, and these complex problems are much less tractable with quantum chemistry-based methods. One reason for the complexity is, of course, the reaction network, the network of reactions that can take place on the catalyst surface. Here I show an example for the conversion of CO and hydrogen into fuels and chemicals. And this is only a subset of the reaction network that you would observe for this problem. You can see that there are so many reactions that it becomes very expensive to simulate all of them computationally. Another degree of complexity comes from the complexity of the catalyst surface itself. Usually when we use density functional theory and quantum chemistry based methods, we have to make a lot of assumptions on the structure of the catalyst. Usually we only study simple catalyst facets, and this causes us to miss a lot of important catalyst dynamics that occur at larger length scales and time scales, which are very important for describing performance at reactor scales. So these are two of the biggest challenges, and the reason why quantum chemistry on its own is not enough to solve the problem. And so to mitigate this, there was a big breakthrough made by Meta Fair some years ago, where they reshaped computational catalysis by developing AI models, machine learning interatomic potentials, or MLIPs, which learn from large databases of quantum chemistry calculations. And these MLIPs drastically reduce the cost of a lot of tasks that are required for computational catalyst discovery. For example, transition state search and also finding the global minimum adsorption energy on a catalyst surface. These MLIPs were trained over a very large number, hundreds of millions of density functional theory calculations across the periodic table. And these models, which we call pre-trained models, are very strong at critical catalysis tasks, especially when combined with computational catalysis workflows like those that we develop here. These pre-trained models can achieve huge speedups on materials discovery tasks. Here I show transition state search as an example, where we can use these pre-trained models in our workflows to perform a transition state search for a number of reactions on a catalyst surface within a couple of days on a single GPU, whereas with quantum chemistry alone, this would have taken more than a million CPU hours to complete. So these AI models are extremely exciting in that they can reduce the computational time from millions of CPU hours to a couple of days on a GPU. But these AI models are not perfect. They cannot correct missing physics in the training data. In particular, in order to generate these large databases of surface reactions, which are used to train these data-hungry models, a number of sacrifices had to be made in the plane wave cutoff, the treatment of magnetism and dispersion, and the exclusion of certain elements in order to achieve the throughput needed to generate such a large database. But the flip side of this is that when we look at the accuracy for certain problems, for example, the modeling of 3D transition metal catalysts such as cobalt, nickel, and iron, we find limitations. And that's shown here in the volcano plot for selectivity to acetaldehyde here on the left, where if you compare the density functional theory calculations, which are circles, to the machine learning interatomic potential predictions from the pre-trained model in diamonds, you can see that the model, the pre-trained model, misclassifies the peak catalyst of cobalt. And this is directly as a result of the lack of treatment of spin polarization in the training data. In order to improve the fidelity of data sets available for treating magnetism as well as other properties of catalysts, we generated the AQCat25 data set, which is a database of 13.5 million sample structures generated on the NVIDIA DGX cluster that we use to train machine learning interatomic potentials that understand magnetism. In this data set, we adjusted the plane wave cutoff of our calculations to 500. We included off-equilibrium structures such as transition states, and of course, we added spin polarization for 12 elements as listed here. So AQCat25 emphasizes off-equilibrium and non-metal structures in particular compared to the general OC20 dataset that came before it. As you can see from the plots on the right, AQCat25 has a higher proportion of systems with higher forces and higher energies. This helps our models learn these off-equilibrium geometries and energies. And it has been shown in past work that the description of non-metal systems is actually one of the most challenging tasks in training these models. And so our data set actually includes a larger percentage of these non-metal structures compared to metal structures, which are described very well. When training a model with data that contains mixed fidelity and mixed physics, so different plane wave cutoffs and the inclusion of spin polarization, there are a number of challenges in model training that we had to address here. In order to study this thoroughly, we looked at a number of training strategies and model architectures. For example, we considered direct fine-tuning of OC20 models with AQCat25. We also considered co-tuning pre-trained OC20 models with a replay of OC20, meaning we brought back some of the OC20 data during the co-tuning process. And then we also co-trained models from scratch using both AQCat25 and OC20. In terms of model architectures, we focused on the vanilla Equiformer V2 published previously. And we also modified Equiformer V2 with spin and fidelity context, given that we have mixed fidelity and mixed physics data here. So here are some results shown from direct fine-tuning, which is the most obvious first choice we would make when trying to build a model using AQCat25. You can see from the plots here for forces and energies, the mean absolute errors. If you look at just the pre-trained Equiformer V2 models from OC20, you can see that on the AQCat25 test set, they're very high errors for both forces and energies. When you directly tune on AQCat25, which are the two sets of bars here and here, you can see that we considerably improve the forces and the energies on AQCat25 data, but there's a significant cost when you look at the performance on OC20 validation metrics. You can see that the OC20 validation metrics drift significantly from the pre-trained model's performance, particularly on forces. To mitigate the limitation of direct fine-tuning, we explored joint training, where we included both AQCat25 data and OC20 data when training. As you can see from the plots on the left, in particular this plot here, when we co-tune and co-train with OC20 data, we significantly improve OC20 validation performance as we show more OC20 samples to the model. The limitation of this, as you can see from the gray and yellow lines here, is that the performance on AQCat25 forces is higher than in the case where we fine-tuned just with AQCat25 on its own. And to mitigate this, we adapted Equiformer V2 in order to include spin and fidelity context via film embeddings, and that's shown here on the right-hand side. And you can see that when we include the film embeddings in addition to co-tuning or co-training, the models are able to achieve state-of-the-art performance on AQCat25 without sacrificing generalizability to the OC20 dataset. And so we can take these models that we've trained on AQCat25, and we can go back to the example that I showed earlier where Cobalt was misclassified. And you can see that the performance of Cobalt is now in the regime where it would be predicted to be a good catalyst, as we would expect. Conversely, metals in the rest of the plot here that were described fine before and didn't exhibit strong magnetism did not shift significantly between the pre-trained OC20 models and the AQCat25 models. And this gives us confidence that the model retains a lot of the information that it knew before and that co-training or co-tuning didn't degrade the performance on OC20 metrics. As an additional point, the inclusion of additional transition state and off-equilibrium data helped in the prediction of transition state search as well. Now, that was just one example of the performance on microkinetic modeling. We also benchmarked the robustness of the models more generally through a metric called the global minimum adsorption energy. We generated a dense data set of 109 adsorbate slab pairs, and this was generated to test models on the practical catalysis task of identifying the lowest energy on a particular surface. And you can see the results here for the pre-trained Equiformer V2 model, the directly fine-tuned model, and our best co-trained model with film embeddings. You can see that if we ask the question of which model provided the largest percentage of structures within 0.1 electron volts of the DFT energy, you can see that there's a significant improvement from the model that was jointly trained with spin and fidelity context compared to both the baseline and the direct fine-tuning models. We're really excited about the use of these models for catalysis involving magnetic systems, but also across the periodic table on a large number of catalyst systems. And so we've released these AQCat25-EV2 models on Hugging Face for the academic community to test and develop upon. And thanks so much for your attention. Now I'll pass it to Paul, who's going to tell us about NVIDIA's role in our project, which was very critical.
Thanks, Aayush. Let's dive into how NVIDIA's DGX Cloud AI Accelerator team partnered with SandboxAQ to build and operationalize scalable GPU infrastructure, enabling both the training of a large quantitative model and the creation of a massive dataset of over 11 million DFT calculations. But first, what is DGX Cloud? DGX Cloud offers managed on-demand compute capacity backed by NVIDIA's deep expertise. It runs on top of leading Tier 1 cloud service providers and NVIDIA Cloud partners, incorporating best practices from across our infrastructure and software technology stack. Essentially, it's NVIDIA's performance and reliability delivered through the convenience of the cloud. Now, before scaling up compute, we collaborate closely with each customer to ensure every prerequisite for success is in place, from defining intended outcomes and preparing datasets to configuring environments, integrating internal systems, and aligning security protocols across your CSP, NVIDIA, and your own organization's standards. The goal is to accelerate your time to first train while maintaining complete operational confidence. Our engagements also focus on building lasting foundations, creating replicable playbooks for DevOps, FinOps, MLOps, and engineering. These frameworks empower teams to seamlessly transition from NVIDIA's managed AI accelerator environments to their own cloud or on-premise data centers, equipped with the same patterns proven at scale. Now, let's look at how this partnership helps SandboxAQ achieve their goals. For SandboxAQ, success began with securing right-size capacity for each phase of their engagement. This involved leveraging DGX Cloud on Google Cloud Platform to integrate smoothly with their existing infrastructure. We provisioned a managed Kubernetes training environment powered by 768 H100 Tensor Core GPUs. And throughout the engagement, our AI accelerator team continuously monitored every layer of performance, from nodes and operators to schedulers and individual GPUs, to identify and remove bottlenecks. We fine-tuned GPU, CPU, networking, and storage components while continuously optimizing training frameworks to reach peak efficiency. In parallel, our engineers partnered directly with SandboxAQ's research teams to re-architect key GPU workloads, migrating CPU-bound tasks to the GPU whenever feasible, and applying NVIDIA's domain expertise to enhance throughput and accelerate results. The outcome spoke for itself. During both dataset generation and training, SandboxAQ sustained GPU effective utilization above 95%, averaging 600 watts per accelerator across 2 million GPU hours. That's remarkable efficiency, especially given the computational demands of their DFT workflow. Ultimately, our mission was simple: free SandboxAQ's researchers to focus on discovery and innovation while we manage the heavy lifting of GPU orchestration and performance optimizations. Operating GPU infrastructure at this scale is challenging, and our engineers and architects take real pride in supporting SandboxAQ's vision. Collaborating side by side to turn ambitious ideas into reality is exactly what the AI Accelerator program was built for. Now, back to you, Aayush.
Thanks, Paul. We really appreciate the collaboration and support from NVIDIA. And thanks to all of you for listening to this webinar. Please reach out to us if you would like to learn more and collaborate. Thank you very much.